What are you doing in Hungary?
I came over here. I was invited over here to speak at a conference. I debated Lanny Davis in Prague a couple of days ago. I think Lanny and I are going to do some debates throughout Europe and maybe the United States. So we kicked off in Prague, and I was invited to a conference of the Visegrad nations. Had a strategic conference, and I gave a speech at it. And so I'm here for a few days just to learn. You know, I pick up a lot, as you and I have talked about in the past. I learned a lot that helped on the Trump campaign by going to England in 2013 and 2014 prior to the European parliamentary elections and following around a guy named Nigel Farage.
But
and
specifically, so, you know, being in a place like Budapest, you were in Prague the other day. I think you've been to Paris to see Marine Le Pen.
Yes.
Do you think that Europe is now the kind of battleground for your particular idea?
Oh, absolutely. And it's by the way, Europe leads in this populist nationalist revolt. Europe is about a year and a half ahead of the United States. That's why the European parliamentary elections of 14 were so important. It's why Brexit came before 2016 Trump. You've seen, I think, two tremendous, huge things happen in the last couple of months. That is the anti-establishment vote, two-thirds vote in Italy, and now the forming of a populist government, and the two-thirds anti-establishment or nationalist vote here in Hungary. So yes, this is a hotbed. Europe's a hotbed right now for this populist national, and I'm learning every day.
But so you're a political tourist of sorts?
Well, political observer.
Observer, yeah. An advisor perhaps?
No, every now and again I will give my advice if somebody asks for it. Oh, the guys in Italy, I talked to Salvini, spent time with Salvini and Armando Siri afterwards a little bit to talk about, gave him my opinion, my ideas about why it would be logical to have a unity government instead of trying to do it yourself.
And they're listening to you.
I didn't say that, but I think on occasions, if people ask, they'll take it into consideration.
Are you trying to bring down the European Union, or do you see yourself as a witness in its demise?
No, not bring it down. I think the European Union is, I'm a big believer in the populist movement and the nationalist movement. I think the European Union is already starting to change. I think what's going to change is to a union of nations instead of like this version of the United States that it was trying to become. So I think you're already seeing it go down that path. And I wouldn't say, you know, if people say it's going to be destroyed, I think that's probably an oversell. But I'm an observer of that. And every now and again, if someone asks for my humble opinion, I will give it.
But just today, there was an opinion poll out saying that actually Europe, the EU, has not been this popular since the financial crisis. So ordinary Europeans in places like Hungary, Italy, France, Germany, actually think, you know what, Europe's the real deal.
Well, that's what I think. Remember, I think it's two types of the European Union. I'm not sure you've got a burning desire right now to actually exit, right, and break it up. I think what it is like Marine Le Pen, it says, is the nation state an obstacle to be overcome, or is it a jewel to be polished and nurtured? And I think you're seeing where people want their countries back, and people want their nations back, and people want their national identities back. And so I think we're at that phase. So I think when they talk about the EU or do this polling, that's really what people are responding to. But I think that the days where they're going to be treated like states, like Nebraska or North Carolina or, you know, South Carolina, it may have passed.
But the particular strategy that all these nationalist populist parties use in whichever country you're dealing with is fear and loathing. You know, fear of foreign migrants, loathing of the elites, the rise, the resurgence of nationalism. We went through that experience 80 years ago, and it wasn't so good. We have learned from history that that is not the way to the future.
I think that is a simplification. That's the globalist, you know, that's the classic globalist, you know, put down. I think if you look at these,
it's history.
By the way, if you look at these campaigns, it's not all negativism. It's about what they can be as countries. It's about saving their country. It's not just fear and loathing. That's an oversimplification.
In this country, there was a massive campaign. The election campaign that Viktor Orban fought and won resoundingly was based on two things. Fear of migrants, you know, the Muslim hordes are coming over the fence, and George Soros. Do you know how many Syrian refugees are in Hungary right now?
By the way, a couple of thousand
at most.
By the way, the number of refugees who are coming through, I think the 400,000. Would be equivalent of 12 million in the United States.
But they went through. They ended up in Germany.
12 million in the United States. Okay, so you got to remember.
They traveled
through. I know, but you got to remember what happened here was quite dramatic. Okay, so I think what Viktor Orban was arguing and what the people of Hungary bought into is the fact that hey, we're a nation state. We're a country. right? We have a border, and if we want to, right, if we want the ability to put a wall on that border, right, and save our country, we can do it. And but so I think that, by the way, I think it's very positive. It's the globalist, right? They sit there and go, oh, look at this fear and loathing. Here's why it's fear and loathing. You're part of the propaganda arm of the globalists, right, the mainstream media. You're losing elections. I understand when
I'm not part of any propaganda. I'm just a reporter. And
I know.
Observer.
Okay. Just a simple
now
observer.
You're simplified.
No, simplifying observer.
No, you're simplified.
You guys are the propaganda wing of the the Financial Times of London, the Economist, the BBC, Channel 4. You're part of the propaganda. The propaganda arm.
Steve Bannon, because that's the opposition party. You're far too clever to be this simplistic
So. I think you guys see it as fear and loathing. I think most people see it as a positive outcome. And by the way, it's like the Chinese say today that they are socialism with Chinese characteristics. Hmm. Each one of these movements, whether it's in Poland, whether it's in the Czech Republic, whether it's in Austria, whether it's in Hungary, whether it's in Italy or the United Kingdom, it all has different attributes of
local. So here's where I don't quite follow your argument. So you've got Viktor Orban, Prime Minister of Hungary, populist, nationalist, populist, whatever you want to call him, re-elected. But what he's really doing is lining the pockets of his own family. This is kleptocracy on Putin levels. You know, his son-in-law gets the biggest concession for luxury hotels.
By the way, let me finish.
This is European money, right? So on one hand, he's talking against Brussels. On the other hand, he's taking the cash and giving it.
That's an accusation you guys make. Did the people of Hungary, that was fully vetted, fully vetted. All those arguments came up. That was fully vetted, 5 weeks ago in election when he won two-thirds votes, about all the corruption that was around here, et cetera.
Independent media has been shut down in this country. What do you mean
independent media? People in Hungary know what's going on. You have the papers. You have BBC. You have all this.
They know what's going on.
You're saying the people in Hungary are ignorant? I disagree with that. I think people in Hungary were fully informed and made rations. See, here's the thing.
Budapest were fully informed. They voted against it, people in the rest of the country.
The dumb country roots.
You make them dumb when you shut down their independent newspapers, the same rubes
that voted for Donald Trump. This is the whole scam of the propaganda wing of the globalist movement. That people are too stupid. You know, you love democracy. You guys love democracy when you're winning elections. Now that you're losing elections, and you're losing them big, you're getting blown out. These are two-thirds. All of a sudden, oh my gosh, it's the end of liberal democracy. There's not enough information going to think. The people in Hungary...
But it's not a level playing field. You know, if you shut down opposition media, in other words, people who don't agree with you, which plenty of people are doing, you know, Erdogan's doing it in Turkey, Putin has done it in Russia, he's doing it here in Hungary. If you shut that down, it's not a level playing field.
Here's the thing.
It's not fair. It's not a free and fair democracy.
Here's the thing. You guys always have to bitch and moan and whine. In the United States, it's got to be the big bad Russians came in and stole it. Okay. Here, it's got to be there wasn't enough open media and frank media in a world that's awash in information that the rubes in the countryside didn't understand what they were voting for. Okay, I want you to go into the countryside, today or tomorrow, and go ask the people in Hungary. They know exactly what they're voting for.
I was here two weeks ago, and they said
we don't know what we're voting for.
No, what they said is we're afraid of Muslim migrants, right? And I said to them, well, we went to this one town.
Then why are you pitching why they're not? I thought you were an observer. No, you're pitching the opposite of the party.
I went to an example, because that's what the election campaign was all about. Went to one town.
And what'd you tell
them? I'm afraid the name is unpronounceable because it's too long, but I can get it for you later. Went to this one town. They had a single Syrian migrant in this town. One. And yet the big fear in this town was that they were going to be overrun. That's just nonsense, isn't it? It's just not true.
The equivalent of 12 million in the United States came through here. So if people, people can come to their own conclusions themselves. But I'm sure you were there arguing the opposite side because that's what
I was just curious. Look, I was curious why you would have an election campaign based on a phantom.
Here's what shocks me. The party at Davos loves democracy. Until it starts going against them. And here's what's so stunning. These elections are not even close now. The rejection of the party of Davos in Italy is two-thirds of the vote. And by the way, the old paradigm of left and right doesn't even matter anymore, because you had both a left-wing populist movement and you had a right-wing populist movement that's number one wants to reject what they're being force-fed. And so I think, and by the way, those were, one was an internet party and the other was doing it on Facebook Live.
Why are you so against the Party of Davos? I mean, you're a member of the elite.
I'm most
certainly
not.
Goldman Sachs.
I'm a blue-collar kid. I'm a blue-collar kid that had the great benefit after my naval service.
How are you traveling around Europe at the moment? Private plane?
Actually, we're going commercial.
Oh, are you?
We're going commercial. No, but I've had a great opportunity to go to Harvard, to work at Goldman, have my own firm, sell it to SocGen. Yeah. And by the way, you know, through the sweat of my own brow to make some money. But I've been a populist at heart, and I'm dedicated to this populist movement. The last 10 years, I've dedicated to helping build this populist movement. So I'm a populist, and I'm a nationalist, and wherever I can either observe or give people some advice, I'll be there for them. So by the way, because I can see the problems of what the elites have, and the elites have this kind of arrogance that their decisions are the right decisions, and that local people, the rubes in the countryside that only have one Syrian, only one Syrian, and are too stupid to understand that they shouldn't have any fear, and so they should just vote for the Party of Davos, right? They're going to vote. They're going to vote the way they're going to vote.
I tell you. So here's a serious point.
Okay. That's not a serious point.
That is another serious point. Okay. So you have, you know, the reason why the European Union exists, for better or for worse, is that 70 years ago this continent, you know, was in the middle of slaughter. America got involved. You know, basically helped the right guys to win. That's why we have the European Union. It's to prevent the resurgence of aggressive nationalism.
Well,
right?
I think, nobody signed up at the time. I think you talk to these people, these individual people, you ought to go around and talk to people in these countries. None of them signed up to give away their national identities. None of these countries signed up. By the way, none of these countries signed up, or at least the two-thirds that are voting against it today don't feel that they signed up to take away their national identities and ship that control to Brussels.
But there's a cost to the politics, to the rhetoric fear. There's a cost to that. It's a fine national identity.
This is another.
Okay.
This is another thing. It's a serious answer. You guys, this is what kills me. You know, when you're winning elections, it's okay. But as soon as you're losing, it's the rise of fascism. It's a rise of fear mongering. You just for the simple reason, you can't convince anybody anymore to vote for the Party of Davos. You've got about a third of the people that vote for it. Two-thirds of people, country after country.
This continent has voted for lots of different parties in lots of different countries since the Second World War. You know, and some of them were left-wing, some of them were right-wing, some of them center-left, some of them center-right, whatever. It's not just about the Party of Davos. It is about preventing history from repeating itself in the most vicious form.
I think people in these countries, I think when you go to Poland, I think you go to Austria, you go to the Czech Republic, Hungary, you don't see people here that saying, hey, we want to go back to the 1930s. Remember, it was the elites in those countries, okay? Those were the elites in the countries that drove people to war, if you go back and look at the history of it, not working class people, okay? And so I think you see today that these revolts are truly...
I think people are afraid of a slippery slope.
A true populist movement. Well, you'll have to see that. But I think if you... By the way, I think you guys all make that, oh, that's a big specter, so you shouldn't do it. Here's the bottom line. The Party of Davos has been arrogant. The Party of Davos hasn't worried about what people's patriotism is, what their love of country is, what their love of the cultures are. They've tried to dictate it to it. You see it at country after country after country. And I think what's happening now is that the tables are getting run on you. And as the tables get run on you, you're going to throw up everything in the world. These are fascists. These are potential Nazis. They're going to bring another war. You're going to have the destruction you had 70 years ago. And aren't we wonderful? We protect you from it. If you're so wonderful and you protect them from them, where did you make that sale in Italy? Okay, where did you make that sale in Hungary?
I'm not disputing the fact that there's a crisis, you know, in European democracy.
And by the way, people,
nationalist populist answer to it is the wrong one. That's what I posit.
Okay. Well, I think you're absolutely incorrect.
Why have you got it in for a small Swiss ski resort? You know, I mean, Trump went to Davos, Xi Jinping went to Davos, Erdogan was in Davos. Everyone goes to Davos.
I don't go to Davos. I use Davos as the epitome of it's the scientific, managerial, engineering, financial elite, right, in the city of London and Wall Street to kind of control that. Yeah. These corporatists that don't care about the little guy, right? They look at the little guy as just another unit of production, right, and a unit of consumption. And I think the arrogance of it has been outstanding. And so they, by the way, they had their run, Okay, they had to run, and now they're being, you know, there's a counter to that. There's a counter to that in the United States. There's a counter to that in the United Kingdom. There's a counter to that throughout the continent of Europe. And by the way, there's a counter to that in South Korea.
The little guy, as you call him, not me, the little guy's done rather well since the Second World War in Europe. I mean, levels of prosperity and peace, they've basically gone up and up, and they've stalled recently with the Great Recession. But they're coming up again.
But let's talk,
so actually, it's been a pretty pleasant experience.
Let's talk about that for a second. In the you call it the Great Recession. In the financial crisis of 2008, brought on by the Party of Davos, right? Brought on by the geniuses in Wall Street. And let's talk about how it started.
Goldman Sachs, your old firm.
Goldman Sachs, which should have gone bankrupt that weekend. We're coming up on the 10th year anniversary of it. Let's talk about it a second. On I think it was 9 or 10 o'clock in the morning on the 15th of September in 2008. Lehman Brothers goes bankrupt, and they kick Lehman in bankrupt in London. Okay, and the smartest guys in the room, all these geniuses at Davos, didn't understand one thing: that Lehman Brothers was at the center of capital markets and commercial paper market. So all of a sudden, you have a complete implosion of the financial system of the West. A couple of days later, Hank Paulson and Ben Bernanke have to go into the White House of George Bush and say, "Hey, by the way, we need $1 trillion in cash, and we need it by 5 o'clock." Or the entire financial system of the world is going to implode. Mm. He says, I can't make the decision. Go to Capitol Hill. They go up to Capitol Hill, see Nancy Pelosi and all the heads of the finance committees. And here's what Bernanke tells them. And this is a very, you know, low-key, right, professorial head of the Federal Reserve. He says, if we don't get $1 trillion by tonight, the American financial system will implode in 72 hours. The world financial system, starting in the city of London, will implode in a week. Mm. And we will have in 3 weeks global anarchy. Yeah. No, but here's what happened. Okay? Here's what happened. In the greatest financial crisis we've ever faced, the Federal Reserve's balance sheet at that time was about $880 billion. It's $4.5 trillion today. The ECB and the Bank of Japan have been negative interest rates. What the elites did, what the Party of Davos did, okay, was to open the spigots of liquidity, inflate their way out of here, and take care of themselves. That's where you had tremendous concentration of wealth. If you were an owner of a stock, or real estate assets or intellectual property, you've had the greatest 10-year run you've ever had. Mm. And you talk about the little guy having such a great run. It's the little guy in Europe, hanging in Europe and the United States. It's their tax dollars that paid for this, and they have not got pay raise. Half of the people in the United States of America, 50% of our population, could not put together today $400 in cash. $400 in
cash. But is it not true that they're finally feeling the recovery in the United States? That's one of Donald Trump's great boasts, is that he has made the recovery actually not just real in terms of numbers, but in what people feel.
No, okay, but here's what Trump did. Remember, the elites just took care of themselves, and the devil catched the hindmost, okay? And by the way, they didn't take away from the city of London all the way to Wall Street. They didn't give up any of their stock. Management was not blown out. They didn't give up any of their bonuses. And more importantly, nobody was held accountable. Nobody went to jail. The Party of Davos, we have socialism for the very poor and the very wealthy. We have socialized their downside risk. They're totally mitigated. They have unlimited upside. It's the little guy that pays for it. Now, here's what Trump said. What Trump said is, I hear you. And I know we got to take care of these trade deals. I know we got to take care of tax policy. The tax policy he wanted to put through, he couldn't, which was more, you know, this border adjustable tax. We went to a major strategic tax cut to make our corporations competitive with Germany and China about taxes, and to reinforce investment in the country of high-value jobs. That's why the United States, economic nationalism, we're growing at 3%. Okay, we're growing at 3%. Black unemployment, all-time low. Hispanic unemployment, 20-year low. Wages are starting to rise. That is Trump's economic nationalism program.
So the little guy is actually doing rather well at the
because
moment.
Of populism and nationalism.
Okay.
No. Hang on.
By the way,
hang on. You just bought into my argument. The populist nationalist message, which focuses on workers and focuses on citizens and focuses on their betterment, okay, is what's going to make this system. And if you somehow don't start to share that, you're going to have a revolution.
Okay.
You can't continue on with the wealthy just taking care of themselves. The bailout of 2008. That we're coming on the 10th year anniversary of is absolutely egregious. How the elites in the Western and even in Japan took care of themselves and had average taxpayers pay for it, and not one person held accountable.
Did you call for your former colleagues at Goldman Sachs to be
absolutely?
Know,
by the way,
to be tried, away.
Absolutely. Here, but let me talk about Goldman Sachs. Let's talk about Goldman Sachs for a second. The way you're trained at Goldman Sachs. What you would have gone in, it was debtor in possession financing. Mm-hmm. You'd have blown out the management team. You wiped out all the equity. You got a new management team, and you would have given them 20% warrants or equity in the upside as long as they performed themselves. not what happened. All the TARP loans, et cetera, it was all BS. Goldman Sachs, in fact, on that Monday when they were getting ready to go bankrupt over the weekend, that by one stroke of a pen, Hank Paulson let them become a bank holding company. You know this, where they basically open the doors, they borrowed zero from the Federal Reserve, and they lend at it a couple hundred basis points. They make $4 or $5 billion just by being in business. That's the elites taking care of themselves. Tell me, did one partner at Goldman Sachs lose any equity? Did anybody lose a bonus over time? No, they didn't. And the city of London,
outrageous.
It's totally outrageous.
Right.
But by the way, what do you think? That fuse, Donald Trump is president of the United States, because the fuse that was lit in 2008, and it was the most progressive Democrat, and I'm not blaming Obama for what happened. That happened on Bush's watch.
Right.
And by the way, in the party of Davos, in the permanent political class, it's not about politics. The ideologies aside, this is Democrats and Republicans.
Okay.
However, the most progressive president we've ever had in our country, with Geithner, continued to inflate the balance sheet of the Fed and continue to bail out the elites that own the Democratic Party like they own the Republican Party.
I want to get back to
on record. I just want to make sure that you agree with me that economic nationalism and populism is working.
No, I do not agree with you. But you've made your case. That's fine.
Okay.
I want to move on to something else.
Okay.
Wouldn't we much rather be in the White House with President Trump running the shop
than
being out here,
you
know, going from one country to another?
No.
I mean, you're a political nomad at the moment.
No. It's absolutely not true.
Did you leave off your own volition?
Absolutely.
Yes,
I told John. No.
For the record.
1 hour. 1 year, from August 14th to August 14th, I told John Kelly, after Ryan's, when John Kelly came in to be chief of staff, I told John Kelly, and then the president's personal lawyer, John Dowd, that I was going to leave in a week to 10 days, which is basically on the 14th, and I told Maggie Haberman, the New York Times, was going to do a story, and then Charlottesville happened, okay? And so I said, I don't want to leave in the Charlottesville mess. Let's wait and see if it's a week or two. And at the end of that week, it looked fine. I told Kelly I'll leave that Friday, so no.
How chaotic was the White House?
I don't think it's chaotic at all. I think in hindsight, you look at the chaos under John Kelly and what happened the last couple of months. I think, Reince, you got to remember, when you say chaos, you have to separate out the signal from the noise, okay? Donald Trump is one of the most unique characters ever to be president of the United States. He's 71 years old. He's an entrepreneur that's built a massive franchise, okay, in his own way, own management style, without a chief of staff.
But the impression is one of unadulterated chaos.
That is because the opposite. Did I mention the opposition party media? Okay, that's because the propaganda
wing.
Just
looking at what he puts on his Twitter feed, for instance, primary source.
I think the Twitter feed actually has an internal logic to it, right? It goes over the head.
In the madness.
Absolutely, it's a signal from the noise. I think what he's done, look at the accomplishment. Okay, let's go back for a second. Look at what he's done in national security, okay? The Riyadh conference, okay, where he engaged the Muslim world, okay? On the inaugural day, he gave a quote, and he wrote a line that we told him was a big check that he was going to have to cash. He said, we will rejuvenate old alliances and make new ones and unite the civilized world to come together to eradicate radical Islamic terrorism from the face of the earth. And we told him, that's a huge check you got to cash. In 1 year, we completely annihilated the physical caliphate of ISIS, both in Mosul and Raqqa. Remember, in 2014, in 2014, ISIS was a more vibrant nation state than Syria or Iraq. He did that to unite the Arab world and coming together about financing a radical Islamic terrorism.
Right.
He took on Iran.
But I want to talk about, by leaving after a year, does that make you a quitter?
No. I always have had more, leeway to do what I want to do. I'm not a staffer. Okay, I came into the campaign.
But you're not in the White House anymore.
But
you're watching it from the outside.
It doesn't make a difference. I was a staffer.
You talked to Trump every day?
I was just a staffer in the White House. I was just a staffer.
Come on.
Okay. You must have
loved all the attention.
Absolutely not.
What did they used to call Carl Rove? Bush's brain? Trump's brain?
No, that's the opposition party. Trump makes his own decisions. The opposition party
media.
But
you were on the cover of Time magazine, your eyes glaring out.
The great manipulator.
I still have nightmares about that cover. No, seriously.
No,
you must have loved that attention.
I couldn't stand it.
Of course you did.
I couldn't stand it. If I loved it, I'd still be there. I couldn't stand it.
Dark forces. Darkness is good. That was one of your most famous quotes.
No, let's take
Satan,
the time.
Satan, Darth Vader, Dick Cheney, but not in that order. And you,
Darkness
Steve
is good. Okay, but let's take the cover of Time magazine.
That's not funny, actually.
Let's take the cover of Time magazine. Time magazine asked when they made Donald Trump Man of the Year.
Mm-hmm.
They asked a number of us to come in and to sit for photographs. And the president said, would you please do it? We said yes. It was Reince Priebus and Vice President Pence, Kellyanne Conway, and myself. And that actual exact picture in black, and it's original black and white, is in the annual edition of Time that came out a couple of months beforehand, okay, in a black and white, okay? When Time magazine decided to do the manipulate, they never came to me one time for an interview. And what they did is they took a black and white photograph and they, you know, did some stuff with my skin to make it look more evil, right? To make it look like Satan, and put it up there. That's the opposition party propaganda arm of the globalist.
But you loved it. Be honest.
No, I didn't.
Be honest.
No, I didn't.
That kind of attention, no. You're suddenly...
Absolutely not.
You know,
I've always been a guy who's behind the scenes guy. I don't need attention.
Yeah, you were a Hollywood producer, right? Successfully.
Yeah, but...
And then suddenly you're one of the starring parts.
No.
In a movie of your own writing, to some extent.
No, ridiculous. Always been behind the scenes guy.
Do you miss that kind of attention?
Absolutely not. And I don't miss being in the White House, not one second. No. I was just a staffer. I'm not a staffer. I built up a thing of being an entrepreneur. I like being out here. I've got my thing going on in the United States. I couldn't be happier. Occupied 24 hours a day. So it's great. But when you're in the White House, you're just one voice. You know, we had Gary Cohen, had myself, had McMaster's. And by the way, I got my licks in. I got TPP in Paris and, you know, I got my licks
on that,
in. Moving the capital of Jerusalem, of the embassy. But I'm just another voice, like in the trade meetings, I'm just another voice. So out here I can move with much more mobility. So but it's the opposition party that says, oh, Steve, you must miss it. You must horribly miss it every day.
I've never heard anyone say that before.
You haven't?
No.
Oh,
that's not the opposite. That's just me as an observer.
Okay.
So on the Trans-Pacific trade deal, on the Paris, you know, climate change accord, you know, on the Iran deal, you know, so America pulls the, you know, Trump pulls the plug from these incredibly important, you know, agreements, and they carry on. You know, the Iran deal will, you know, the Chinese and the Europeans will make sure that it carries on in some form. On the Paris Climate Accord, you know, Trump, you know, that's going to carry on.
Let me get to my question. Hang on a minute.
What does this say about America?
It's not carrying on.
But it is.
That's not carrying on. The Paris Accords are some range of kind of attempted goals you're trying to meet. You think the Chinese are meeting that? The Paris Accord is a total joke.
But my point is, America matters less now than it used to.
I think the rest
of the world is moving on.
Oh, you think it's moving on? How is that so? Tell me that's moving on. The United States, the key thing in the Pacific, the bilateral agreements for the United States. The United States pays the entire security for the Pacific, right? When you say it's moving on, it's all dependent upon the United States. That's one of the things. Remember, the post-war international order, right? This of relationships of trade and commerce and capital markets and American security has been on the burden of the American people for 40 or 50 years. That's why we have $1 trillion in armed forces. You know, when you fully load our military and defense and intelligence, is about $1 trillion a year. We're running $1 trillion deficits. Okay, the American
people. Why doesn't America just withdraw the umbrella then? If you don't want to get involved, if you don't want to be the world's policeman, just say come on.
Didn't say that. We are not the world's policeman, and we don't want to be. What we want to be, and this is what I think President Trump has said time and time again, where it's in the vital national security interest of the United States, it'll be in the vital national security of local partners and allies. What people in the United States want, and this is the whole thing with NATO. It's not that they want to get rid of NATO. President Trump has been to many NATO meetings. He's been to the G7, the
G20. Took him a little time talk about Clause 5.
He's doing, but more importantly, what he's talking about is the 2%. What people in the United States and President Trump doesn't want, whether it's in the Pacific, it was in Europe with NATO, or the Persian Gulf, or the South China Sea, or the Northwest Pacific, we're not looking for protectorates. We're not an empire. Okay, we want NATO to be robust. We want it to be healthy. We want the money spent of 2%. We want equipment. We want training.
Do you think that you have become an informal empire? Is that what America is now?
I think I wouldn't call it an empire, but I think we're stretched to try to be the world's policeman. What the globalists of the Clinton ilk have turned the American military into, is essentially a global humanitarian expeditionary force that they can send anywhere. I think what the deplorables and what the American people want and what President Trump wants, okay, is a military that is scaled to the national security interests of the United States in conjunction with partners. That's where, remember, NATO is supposed to be an ally. Right now, you're a protectorate. Everybody knows that nobody pays the 2%, right? Everybody knows, like the German army, even the money that's spent is not on interoperability and not on weapon systems. You have to get back to that. What America is looking for is allies. And by the way, in NATO specifically, is start to focus on where the real threats are. Look what happened in 2015 with the Syrian civil war. It was a couple of million refugees that almost imploded the EU. I think what America thinks, or what many people think, is that the threat to Europe is going to come from the Middle East and sub-Saharan Africa and North Africa with the migrant issue. That's why you have to start focusing on places like Egypt. Mm. Okay, that's why you start focusing on North Africa. It's not that America's going to be isolationist. America's going to be more involved. And you can't say today, by the way, when we've engaged China like we've never engaged before, when we've engaged North Korea like it's never been engaged before, with all the geniuses of the last 40 years, you know, Bush, Clinton, Bush, and Obama, and plus the British, everybody else, looked the other way and kicked the can down the road with a guy who got 50 nuclear weapons and ballistic missile technology to hit Osaka, to hit Tokyo, and now to hit Portland, Oregon. Mm. It's Donald Trump's engagement. So ask the TPP nations, two questions. Who's more engaged now in solving the solution in the Northwest Pacific? And as China has built seven stationary aircraft carriers in the South China Sea during Obama's pivot to Asia, who's more engaged in getting that problem, the United States today or the United States 7 years ago? Donald Trump has been more engaged, the United States has been more engaged than any time in his past history.
Was it a mistake for the White House to issue a commemorative medal?
They didn't issue
for
it.
For a summit that is now not going to take place with North Korea.
This is so beneath you. This is another part of the propaganda arm of the globalist
thing. But hang on a minute. No.
Hang on for a second. What they had to do...
Is it not embarrassing?
It is not.
To issue a commemorative medal?
It wasn't issued. It's not issued.
It was made.
It was leaked. Here's what happened.
But to make one in the first place.
Here's what happened. No. If you're going to have a situation like that, where you're going to have a monumental meeting, okay, to plan for that, a lot of stuff has to come together. Whoever decided that, hey, we should have a medal of appreciation when that happens, you just can't overnight say you get it done. You have to design it, et cetera. What it shows is just like when President Trump got to the White House, they fully leaked the national security apparatus, fully leaked the entire transcripts of calls he had with the president of Mexico and the president Trumbull, prime minister of Australia, in the first 10 days. Mm. The entire thing was leaked. It had never been done before.
White Houses have always leaked. Right,
but not things. This is not the White House.
The impulsivity of a president who says, "Right, this is going to be a great." You know, one minute he's rocket man, the next minute he's a great guy and an honorable leader. We're going to make a deal with Kim Jong-un. It's too impulsive. It sends too many mixed messages.
The signal from the noise. He has a certain operating style. And what I would say is that, step back for a second. The Korean regime has been allowed with the official way business has been done. We've been told for 40 years by the United Nations, by all the administrations in the United States, you know, by MI5 and MI6, you know, do it this way. And what do we end up with? We end up with a guy who's got 40 to 50 nuclear warheads and ballistic missile technology can hit Tokyo today and Portland, Oregon probably tomorrow. Okay? Now, Donald Trump, within 1 year, has engaged that and at least started a process, has started a process to at least maybe have some potential outcome that could end the Korean War on the peninsula and denuclearize. You know, he's just started this process.
Okay? All right.
And but yet the media, the media is all over, oh, the 12th's not going to happen. Hey, like you said, it may happen, it may not.
Talking
but we started a process.
Okay, so this could be a long process.
Right. By the way, if it was Obama, you'd give him another Nobel Prize. You understand this, right?
No, I'm not even going to go there. So,
is
Trump going to be able to see the end of this process, or do you think he'll be impeached after the midterm elections?
Look, it's no, and I've been very, you know, upfront about this, is I think that this November, the Democrats got something that they've always wanted since Trump was elected at 2:30 in the morning on the 9th of November. They find him so unacceptable, okay, and the elites and the globalists find him so unacceptable. They could have handled, I think, Bush winning or Rubio winning or Christie winning. It is Donald Trump's populism, his nationalism, what he stands for, his entrepreneurism, and his person, the way he interacts with the globalists, that they have never accepted him as a legitimate president. You know, within 48 hours, they're crying Russia. And so what they really wanted, what I call the nullification project, what they wanted was a do-over, right? They wanted a do-over. And this November, on November 6th this year, I've said and I've told people, I said, this election, to me, is going to be very simple. It's an up or down vote on impeaching Trump. The Democratic, the opposition party media is a howling mob every day that wants it. The Democratic Party is driving toward that goal. And I think it's going to be very simple. It's a national election. It's going to be a referendum on Trump. You're going to get the whole package, right? Whether if you like the economy, if you like the tax cuts, if you like his national security versus the alternative versus Pelosi. The first thing she's going to do when she becomes Speaker, and then, the 4th or 5th of January, the first thing he's going to move is to impeach
By the way, when he talked to the data geeks like Cambridge Analytica, they say that they swung the election for Trump, not you.
I think, you go back to the Fortune magazine of the head Brad Parscale and Jared Kushner that oversaw the data. I mean, you know, did we have some good targeting? I think we did. I don't think it was as good a targeting as even the Democrats had. And most of that came from the RNC. We had, you know, we had pretty good, you know, targeting, but it was nothing out of the ordinary. This is all pretty basic stuff. This whole thing about the psychology and all the psychology.
So what they
Clapper's saying today, right. Clapper, the head of DNI, mm-hmm. is actually coming out and saying, he's making a statement that the Russians changed it. You know what his evidence is? It's a couple of hundred.
So the Russians didn't swing the election either. They didn't play you.
It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous on the face of it. What Clapper's talking about is a couple of hundred thousand Facebook things. Mm-hmm. Here's the problem. You guys got
80,000 votes made all the difference.
Here's what happened. Did the Russians tell Hillary Clinton not to talk about economic nationalism? Did they tell Hillary Clinton not to go to Wisconsin? Did they tell her not to go up to Michigan and talk to workers? Here's what happened. Is that the Democratic Party, whose base was working people? I come from a Democratic family. You know, I come from a family of Kennedy Democrats. The Democratic Party stopped talking to those people. And remember, I first came on the campaign. Hillary Clinton was on the beach in the Hamptons raising money. She came off, and I'm sitting in the control room of the war room we had with all the rapid response guys with, you know, 30 TV sets. She comes on in Reno and make her first big speech. Well, it's Breitbart, the alt-right, Bannon. It's identity politics. What she focused on, her campaign was about identity politics. Donald Trump's was very simple. It was some basic economic ideas about bringing jobs back from China, about stopping mass illegal immigration so you can stop the pressure on working class blacks and Hispanics in our country. It was fairly basic
stuff. Was data from Facebook misused?
No, I don't think misused. Here's the thing with Facebook. I think everybody's got to come to grips with it because now they come with 200 apps. Facebook, this is what amazes me. It's like, I can't believe there's gambling going on in this casino. Here's your winning. Facebook's business model, its entire business model, is to sell, monetize your personal data, which you give over for free. Mm. Okay, that's the business model. And that's what I've argued. If you go back to my speeches in Alabama and Arizona and throughout the country when I left the White House, from September on, I've been arguing that we've got to take the data of Google and Facebook and drop it into public trust, that you get the ability to opt in or opt out. And if you opt in, you're going to be paid for your data. Yeah. People generate information and data every day. They ought to be compensated for it. By the way, you're also going to have to pay for Facebook and Google's services, but there'll be price discovery, and you'll figure out what type of service you want. So the big thing on data and micro-targeting, by the way, when Obama did this in 2008 and 2012, you guys herald him as a saint. Remember, executives
from Facebook. It wasn't illegal, there was it?
None of this has been illegal. Facebook, when Facebook and Google sent executives, they met Obama in the San Francisco airport, senior executives in 2008, and said, hey, we want to work for you, and we will secondee executives to your campaign. You guys hailed it as the greatest moment in history, that finally Silicon Valley was learning how to be politicized. When Obama did it, he was a conquering hero. You know, when Trump kind of had some rudimentary, and believe me, it was rudimentary. Here's what we had. You know what we had? We had Donald Trump going to 7 rallies a day with 25,000 people, and you're tweeting out where he's going to go, and people were getting people putting those things up on Facebook.
I guess what people hate about, not everyone, but many people hate about Trump is the language he uses, the misogyny, you know, some of it quite racist, frankly. That's what
like
they don't like.
Like, give me an example.
Well, I mean, you know,
what the global elite, the propaganda, no, you have deemed yourselves the arbiter. Just like here in Hungary, you said at the very beginning, the poor rubes in the countryside are too stupid to understand.
I never said that.
You implied they're too dumb to understand. There's only one Syrian in town.
All I said is they don't get the information that they should get from an election.
And they're too dumb to go find it. Well, you know what? I don't think people are that dumb. I think people find the information they need. Okay. Just like the language you say. You guys are the arbiters of what's acceptable and what's not acceptable. Yeah. And what you said is this language is racist. It's nativist. It's xenophobic. It's all these terrible things. Yet. The deplorables, and by the way, the perfect thing was Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton goes on September 10th, goes to Wall Street, okay, with a big fundraiser where she raised $5 million, and she has Babs. Barbara Streisand's going to be the headliner. She comes out with a written statement, not off the top of her head, a written statement. And what does she say? 50% of Trump's supporters are deplorable, okay, and they're irredeemable, okay? That is the globalist party at Davos. The contempt they have for the working men and women of our country, the backbone of our civic society, the backbone of our armed forces.
But you need that anger, you need that rage to win, don't you?
I think it'd be very helpful this November for the deplorables to understand what the stakes are. There's anger on the other side. I mean, what we're up against is a quite primal movement. This Time's Up movement that I have been looking at and telling people, I said, hey, this is deeper than the Me Too movement. The Me Too movement is about sexual harassment and women being abused in office places and other things. This Time's Up movement that's kind of superseding that is a fundamental, primal, political, cultural movement.
This is the Tea Party equivalent on the left.
It's even bigger than the Tea Party. The Tea Party in 2010, and people forget that we won 62 House seats, really on anger, right? Anger and fear, no money. It was the biggest House, I think, shift since the Great Depression, 1932. I can see that, and I've seen it in Alabama, I've seen it in Virginia, I've seen it in Pennsylvania 18. You saw it the other night with these female candidates. There is a movement, right? This Time's Up movement that is quite profound. And it's right now, people say, well, it doesn't have any leaders, doesn't have policies. I said, hey, it's
self-organized. Is that movement going to defeat Donald Trump?
That movement is not going to defeat Donald Trump. If this fall, this election is nationalized, and you make it an up or down referendum on President Trump and what he's achieved and what he is to achieve his policies. If those two forces clash, Trump will win. If the Republican establishment have the way they want to do it, and do a congressional district by congressional district around tax cuts here and something else here, I think the Time's Up movement will swamp them. And so I think it's very important that people start to focus on, there's a referendum on Donald Trump, there's a referendum on his presidency. I also think that Mueller and all the reports they're going to do, they'll come out, and people will have an ability to vet that, to weigh and measure it, and to vote on November 6th and to say, hey, I've seen the Mueller report. I've seen what he said about a structure of justice. I've seen what he said about Russian involvement, and we're going to vote on it. And November 6th will be a landmark day in American political history.
Final question. Is there anything, Steve Bannon, that you've done in the last year and a half that you're ashamed of?
Oh, absolutely not. I'm actually quite proud of what we've done and what we've accomplished. And I hope to accomplish more in the future. So
No regrets?
Zero. Not a regret in the world. I think that this populist movement is now really gaining steam. I see that it's bringing freedom. People are more engaged. You saw what happened in Italy. I see every day in the United States are people just are getting more fired up. I love it. I think
is it going to improve people's lives?
Absolutely.
Well,
look at
better health care.
I said the other day, Martin Luther King, I think, would be very.
You can't live off fear and anger, can you?
You can live off a 3% growth economy. You can live off lowest black unemployment in history, the history of our country. Lowest Hispanic in 20 years.
That's America. Working class, I'm talking about Europe.
Working class jobs starting to increase. Look, Europe's a different situation. The one fundamental difference, if we can close on this, is that the kind of right-wing populism in the United States is one of our big parts is deconstruction of the administrative state. One of the things of right-wing populism is that we don't want, you know, we want tariff deals, we want to make sure that we've got, you know, a system that can work. But we don't want overweening single-payer health care. We want manufacturing jobs back to provide good health care. We want to have less state involvement, okay?
Right.
Not no state involvement. We're not libertarians or anarchists, but limited state involvement. In Europe, you know, there's still the natural default position is to look to the state to solve the solutions. I think in Italy it's going to be a very important test case because these guys are taking over a situation that has had the ECB have, three of the last five governments have been technocrats put in there. They're 130% already, I think, their GDP in debt, which is usually the point of no return. They've got a very tough road to hoe down there. And I think the Italian people are going to find out that there's only so much you can lean on the state, that eventually you've got to start to deconstruct the state and unlock the entrepreneurial spirit of your people.
Steve Bannon, thanks very much.
Thank you very much for having me. It was great.